Bottom Line, the SKNVibes production that highlights political, social and cultural issues and events within the Twin Island Federation of St. Kitts and Nevis, the Caribbean region and further afield.
A very good day to all viewers and listeners who have logged on to SKNVibes.com. I am Stanford Conway, host of today's edition of The Bottom Line, the first in a series of panel discussions on and the assessment and analysis of issues and events within St. Kitts and Nevis, the Caribbean region, and further afield. Today's discussion will be held on a topic called the blame game, which was initiated by an article published in SKNVibes headline, "Isn't it time politicians move away from the blame game?" In the studio with me to discuss this topical issue are, on my immediate right, the Team Unity's caretaker for constituency number 2, Attorney at Law, Ambassador Jonel Powell. On his right is the St. Kitts Nevis Labour Party caretaker for constituency number 8, Dr. Terence Drew. And next to him is the well-known educator and chemist, Mr. Nourish Nitar. And finally, on the extreme right, is former government minister and co-founder of Operation Rescue, Mr. Dwight Astafan.
Good day, good evening.
Now, gentlemen, before we go into today's discussion on the blame game, I would like to highlight what I have seen. And for as long as I can remember, I have found that political parties in the Caribbean region have always been blaming their predecessors for the things they had inherited. When I say that, I mean the state of affairs that they had inherited within their respective countries. You find that politicians also blame each other. And among the things that they have been casting blame upon each other include leadership. And they call things of that nature failures, poverty, organizational structure, culture, and very importantly, social ills. I would like us also to focus on the accusations that would have been made by various parties when they're in government and when they're in opposition. So I want us to look at all of those from the perspective also of when you would have found that political parties would have made promises during election campaigns. When they get into office and they found that the time frame that there is in which they would have fulfilled these promises, they found that it cannot happen for some reason or the other, and the blame is cast on the predecessor. So therefore, those are the areas of discussions, those perspectives I would like you to discuss with our viewers and listeners on SKNVibes.com.
There's so much you can say with regard to your perception of the genesis of this, but it is part of human nature to blame others. A part of human nature that seems to be more cultivated than the other part of human nature, which is to be forthright and to accept responsibility for yourself. Politics, unfortunately, are not necessarily restricted to our country, but unfortunately, politics is built all too often on deception and distraction, and in such an arrangement, blaming is an easy tool. It's in the toolkit of that type of politics. There's enough blame to go around. And it is true, we don't give each other credit. One of the problems is, Mr. Conway, the lack of information flows from government to the public. If the public had more access to more information, if our education system was more relevant and geared not just to people getting 14 CXCs and other things like that, but geared to them becoming rounded, balanced, civic-minded, politically conscious, culturally conscious, dignified and proud individuals, independent thinking individuals. The contrivance of finger pointing would be far less effective. It would have no currency in the political discourse, because then we would be an enlightened modern democracy, which we are not. We are far from it. So it continues. Freedom of information is critical. Integrity in public life is critical. And governments, administrations, it is easy to go back and say, well, Bradshaw and them ought to have done it in the 60s and 70s and so forth. And as I said, we could spend lots of programs going into the genesis of these things. If you have these things institutionally embedded in the political culture of the country, a more relevant and progressive education system. And there are models in the world. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. Singapore, Finland, Hong Kong, a number of other countries, Japan, where people are properly educated, whether it's in academics or in the technical side, but all in the human development side. Citizenship, independent mindedness, pride in your culture and yourself, lack of dependency on politicians, then the whole narrative would change. And I think that is where I would want to approach it, the discussion as to, yes, it does exist, but how can we change it? Because if it isn't changed, we're just really wasting time.
Okay. Mr. Nital?
Yes, a pleasant good day to all listening. I think when you have persons vying for a political position to represent the people, there must be a natural sequence of information. I entrusted my confidence in you in terms of your ability, your trustworthiness, and your honesty. When things happen, there must be information flowing in a timely manner. What we have around here sometimes is some critical gaps. Things happen and persons are not brought up to date as to the status. And if those elected would sense the urgency with which people need to be informed and therefore pointing to the Freedom of Information Act, I think what happened is that after you realize you find yourself hitting against a wall, you know, go back in time and say, well, at this earlier date, this was supposed to happen. and it did not happen. As a result of that, this is what we now have. But if at that particular juncture, somebody would have indicated the challenges or the achievements back then in a timely manner, there'll be no need to say what transpired back then. And as a result of that, we don't have a euphemism sort of environment where people use indecent enough words to say who was responsible for the lack of timely information. And because that lack of information would have created a dent in the silky flow of things, then you have to say who is responsible for all those undulations that would have occurred along the way. And it comes in the name of blame, because you're not going to tell the people, look, I'm responsible for that. Because one thing we ought to realize is that we can delegate accountability. We can delegate responsibility, but we cannot delegate accountability. And when it reaches the person who is accountable for something, then they bring it back down the ladder and go to the person who is responsible for getting the sequence of events done. And that is what you call blame, because the person who is accountable was not really the person who was responsible. And because of that gap, it created a need, an atmosphere for an explanation. And this explanation comes in the form of blame, because nobody wants to look bad in the eyes of the person who first entrusted the confidence in them, had the confidence entrusted in them by the poor man, the lesser person, so to speak, with respect to decision making. And we get this blame going around and around. It's as if the less I am blamed is the better looking I am in the eyes of the person who put me here to do a specific job. And we'll talk much more about it. Okay. I'll give Mr. Joe a chance.
Yes, yes, good day, Mr. Moderator. Thank you so much, and pleasant good afternoon to fellow participants in this first discussion on this new program called The Bottom Line. Congratulations on your new program, sir.
Thank you.
And I'm happy for the invitation. When I reflect on history, and you reflected a lot on it, having been born in the latter part of the 1970s, my knowledge of years earlier would have come from my reading of history and studying history, especially a book that is called For the Good That We Can Do, that was put out by the St. Kitts and Nevis Party, an excellent book which I encourage everybody to have a read of. And that informs me that there was always a lot of blame to go around. When I look at what the St. Kitts and Nevis Labour Party would have achieved through the action of our leader then, the Right Honourable Robert Llewellyn Bradshaw, as he brought democracy to adult suffrage, he was responsible for really getting back our lands to our people, educational system, comprehensive healthcare system. And even though he would have done so much, he was still blamed for a lot of things. So I do agree with the premise that this blame game has been going on for a very long time. And so even in today's political atmosphere, we still see a lot of blame going around. As one of the panelists said earlier, you know, we cannot deny that there's some level of blaming that goes around. What is totally shocking, though, at times, is when you are blamed for things for which the other person has 100% responsibility. I would talk in terms of, for example, the Information Act was spoke about. I think that if people were promised that there would be a Freedom of Information Act, then it should be done. And no one else can be blamed for that. If you talk about integrity in public life, and that was a promise that you made, it is not delivered, I don't think that there's anybody to really blame. If you speak about the timeline, for example, of a motion of no confidence, and it is not being done, then there's nobody else really to be blamed. And when I look at what we call blame, if it is done in a way that is not wholesome, what I call wholesome debate, really to discuss the issues, because this type of debate can never be extracted from a society that is democratic. It is right to have robust debate on issues that are most important. When the debate would take negative directions as far as starting to blame without any foundation, I think that you would have really entered into the realm of a great deal of negativity, which would have effects on public discourse and the smooth flow of our political process. You know, that's really a detriment to all of that. And so, as a fledgling politician, one who has just entered the field fairly recently, of course, comparing myself to, you know, Dwyer Stefan, I hope and I see that the young generation is looking for a difference. And, you know, it is my pledge going forward, whether in parliament or not, to really engage in meaningful and robust debate that will benefit our people and will benefit our country. So I hope that as a new generation, we would have learned from the last generation that we can do better and we must do better. But as I close off, this is the aspiration I would think of all countries around the world, where people hope to really have a good, you know, democracy, where people participate in robust debate and not necessarily the petty blaming each other for things really that the other person may not have any control over, but just for political expediency and mileage, those type of engagements are sought after. And so I would say that the blame game, it's not good for democracy, but robust debate is what I will promote, and I hope we can take it to that level.
Thank you. Mr. Powell?
Let me join in greeting you, Mr. Moderator, and my fellow panelists, and obviously those who are tuned in to this program. Let me as well congratulate yourself and SKNVibes on this new forum for which issues affecting the nation can be properly discussed and debated. I'm pleased to be invited and humbled to be a part of the inaugural panel. I have read the article on SKNVibes that has instigated this discussion today, and it's very interesting. I think it's quite topical at the moment. Where you still have a fairly new government in place. It's not been 2 years quite yet since the Team Unity administration has taken office. And so I think it's topical. And, you know, I believe that this issue of the blame game comes down to the political maturity of not just our politicians, but our society at large. But perhaps more influenced by politicians. But I would hasten to advise that we not get mixed up between what we perceive to be the blame game and legitimate criticism. You know, it's easy to throw around these things. I believe probably the most the most talked about issue or topic that I believe has been affected by this so-called blame game is the issue of crime, where over the past few years and in the most recent election in particular, in light of the high levels of crime that we've unfortunately suffered both here in St. Kitts and Nevis, it was easy for one side to blame the incumbent prior to the election and say, boy, the Labour Party is responsible for the state of affairs as it relates to crime. And then for an election to come, a new government is elected, and yet you have, I believe, some 30 murders in a year, as well as you know other crime. And so the no opposition says, well, boy, it's team unity, it's their fault, you know, they talk about crime and they haven't done anything, and the crime is not affected by the politics. The bullets don't show yellow or red or green or blue or orange. And so I believe that is a perfect example of the blame game that we need to shy away from. Crime is an issue that we all, as a nation, as a people, need to come together and do something about. It cannot be simply thrown at the feet of the government. And then I contrast that with something like, say, corruption, where I believe it is a legitimate criticism in many instances to highlight any areas perceived or actual of corruption, particularly in high office, especially when it relates to the government. I don't see that as being part of the blame game, but as our duty as citizens to see something that we perceive to be wrong happening, something that affects the country, perhaps the government coffers, and to speak out against it. And so I don't want us to get confused between those two things. But I believe in order to achieve that, there must be proper education of our people as to what is happening. And this comes through, as some of the other panelists have discussed, things like you know, integrity in public life, legislation, freedom of information, in legislation. Again, issues which have been subjected to criticism and, in some instances, the blame game. You know, you had, for example, at the change of government in 1995, a lot of talk about by the then newly elected Labour Party about, you know, the PAM government's lack of integrity in public life and this sort of thing. And here we are, 20 something years later, with having experienced another change of government, same criticisms of the Labour Party having not implemented such legislation after 20 years. We're 2 years into a team unity government, and we're hearing criticism of that still, and the absence of that today. And so it continues, it's a cycle. But I believe we need to stop hiding a lot of the historical facts in order to educate our people better and to shift the conversation from the blame game to constructive criticism. And so we need to stop hiding historical facts and decisions which have been taken by administrations for particular reasons. People need to be aware as to what decisions were taken and why were taken at particular points in history and time. And then Dr. Drew touched on it. There's the issue of, or the question of, did you, I'm talking about as politicians and administrations, governments, did you have an opportunity to change or do better? It's one thing to criticize when you're in opposition, and being a PAM candidate and a member of the People's Action Movement, because of the recent political history, going from opposition to government to opposition and back to a part of the government, you have a different perspective. And there are other examples which I'm sure we'll touch on, but at the end of the day, you have look at the opportunity as an incumbent, look at the opportunity you have now, and rather than blaming the former, you were elected because you criticized them, and to make a difference. So make the difference and forget what happened before. I should pause there, as I know we have quite a bit to cover.
Okay, thank you. I would like to bring to the fore a document that was published by the Embassy of the United States of America that spoke to the transition of power. I would just like to read an excerpt, which is said that, and I quote, "Transitions challenge any political system. In healthy democracies, fair elections and peaceful transitions demonstrate that today's losers might be tomorrow's winners. Winners and their supporters remain responsive to the opinions of their rivals, keeping an eye on the next election cycle. Losers and their advocates can focus on present and future possibilities rather than past resentments, confident that the rules can work for the next time going into election, the more easily accepted existing political order, and they must not resort to violence." In other words, I look at it, they're claiming here that, okay, you have lost the election, accept it gracefully. Do not speak about violence and so on and so forth, but speak about what you have done in the past for the people in your country, for the nation, and strive to even work together as a government and opposition to make the people, to make the country better economically and otherwise, so that you will find in future elections you stand a chance of getting back into office. Well, gentlemen, I would quickly like us, let's say, a minute each of you to speak on we would call the transition of power, briefly. And who will we start with?
I can start. Let me say that I very admire greatly the transition of power in the United States system. That even though two parties might be going at it, at the end of the election, they decide to come together to ensure that the government continues, and so the power is passed on. I think that Jamaica had a very good example of that also, so I don't have to look too far afield. I think that there's some level of maturity within our Caribbean context. However, I think that our situation here in St. Kitts and Nevis leaves a lot to ask for improvement for. For example, in the last change of government, people would really, if they are honest, would have seen that party supporters would have gone to government headquarters. I even see somebody in a hard hat, as if he's going to some construction site, or I don't know what that symbol meant, but went into people's offices. They are not appointed by the government. They are not employed by the government in that office, and yet they felt that they had the power to go in there and really molest those who were there, whether they were Labour Party supporters or otherwise, because I think at that moment, they do not fully understand or did not understand who they were dealing with. And I think that that was a very poor example of transition of power. I, of course, would say that we need improvement as far as that is concerned. And I really think that, that should be pursued. I don't think that is a right for party supporters to go into government headquarters and force people out and tell people your government lose or get out of here. I mean, that this type of thing should not be happening in a modern democracy like St. Kitts and Nevis.
Thank you.
I would like to come next year.
Yeah.
Supporters are one thing, and then you have the authorities who are supposed to be making the transition. Those are the persons we have to focus on, because you have certain persons in position of power, they're supposed to hand it over. But each campaign you have, at the core, is something about corruption. And if I'm accusing you of being corrupt, then when the time comes for you to make that transition, if it is true, you might encounter some problems, because then you have to try and remove all trails, And as a result of you being so antagonistic towards me, I'm not going to make that transition a smooth one. And until we reach a level of maturity, maybe what we need to implement is a grace period. Having won an election, instead of having this instantaneous transfer of power from the time the election results were announced, I mean, the very next second thereafter, we need to say, look, within a month's time, you'll have the complete transfer of power. There and then you can find vital and critical information with respect to existing projects or things that might have been shelved for the next time period. Be transferred to those who would be taking over. Because even though we have different ideologies, different principles, different preference scales, I would need to know what exists now, what shuffling I have to do. But if I don't get the appropriate documentation, paper trail, and that is why we have things like persons like permanent secretaries and these persons who are supposed to assist in facilitating that.
Because
most of the time you will not have the politician themselves humble enough to facilitate that smooth transition.
Okay, would you like to comment on that?
I believe the transition phase is important. I believe in the context of this discussion, while the US probably have a very good model in terms of transition, it doesn't cut out the blame game after. We saw that especially coming after the presidency of George W. Bush. But it must come down to maturity of the political system. And I believe what the US shows is a transition, a change of administration and not a change of government. Governments don't change, administrations change. But unfortunately, due to the divisiveness of our situation in St. Kitts, we try to change governments. We try to change more than just high-level persons. We want to see this person moved on or dismissed because we think they're political. That is something that, you know, certainly we fought in opposition for a long time. And after the most recent change of election, there were some supporters who thought, boy, it's my time now. And I had to remind them, no, this is what we argued and fought against. We don't want this anymore. And so again, it comes down to educating your people. But Dr. Drew again mentioned Jamaica, which is right next door, who does have a short transition period, who has shown maturity, even at the forum at which the mantle is passed over to the prime minister-elect. And then you had individuals who didn't have to do it, but took the personal decision to have their own transition periods. And I can refer to a good friend of mine, Floyd Green, who was a part of the new GLP government, who took it upon himself to invite his predecessor in the ministry, Lisa Hanna, to his office. She held the particular ministry immediately before him. And they had a discussion. It was public, they had a discussion. This is what's happening, you know, this is what we've been working on. And they were able to move forward. And so I believe that is the way we need to move. And even if we can't convince supporters and the wider government, I believe certainly myself as a young politician should take that upon myself to take the lead and show that maturity that is required.
Thank you. Mr. Asifa?
Well, while the transition process in the United States might be more mature and responsible than it is here, I wouldn't use it as the epitome of smooth transitioning. I believe the British system is far more efficient and gracious. I'll have to differ respectfully with my young friend here, Nourish. If you have a transition period, given the rabid politicization of the public service here, I remember one leading politician in the region saying years ago, when you get into government, you stand face to face with a standing army of politicians in the public service inserted by the former administration. And if you have a transitional period, then by time you get in there and get access to the documents and the electronic data, you find little or nothing. And this is not new to St.Kitts and Nevis. It is not new. The behavior of politicians, the rambunctious behavior of politicians on the platform, on the street corners, in the alleyways, and in the parliament, makes it difficult for them to recant that rambunctiousness after they've been defeated. And so they encourage the rambunctiousness and the divisiveness among their supporters. And all of that militates against a smooth and sophisticated and mature transitioning of power. And this is what these young politicians, regardless of which party they represent, have to share in common if this country is going to have a chance to operate to the level of its ability. Here we have three young men, above average in intelligence, leaders. Well, Jonel and Terrence, representing two different political interests. And the collective behavior you hear coming out of the mouths of those political interests are no example at all to set to anybody in terms of being conciliatory, cooperative, and constructive for a nation. It is they, as young politicians and future leaders, who have to change the tone and the substance. Otherwise, whether it is actual governing or transitioning, dog will continue to eat our dinner and will continue to disgrace our ancestors and to shortchange our descendants. And so we have to step up to the plate and let the common cause, the bigger picture, the call to true maturity and responsibility in leadership of a nation take priority over different approaches to nation governing. And if you differences of opinion are not only healthy, you know, the scientists here will tell you they are absolutely necessary. We operate a fundamental contradiction in our politics, Mr. Conway. For anything that I have led, whether it is in sports or politics or whatever, Nital will tell you, I tell the people around me, the first one of you who I detect to be always agreeing with everything I say will be the first one to go, because you're lying to me, or if you're not lying, you can't help me. I want the minds to come together with the different perspectives. Let there be a distillation, robust distillation of ideas. And let us all agree, look, Drew's idea is better than Dwyer's idea. Let's work with that. And it is not beyond us, but we are operating at a level. You see, the divide and rule strategy, paradigm, going back to colonialism. Remember, our people are not a trusting people. You remember the Buckley's Rebellion of 1932, which was the culmination of centuries of frustration. People only got the right to vote with the unions in 1940. Then you had the adult suffrage. But even when you could vote, you had to have a certain amount of money and property. It's only in 1967 that ordinary people were able to go on juries here, jury by trial by your peers. So we have not advanced far enough in terms of our political and social maturity and political maturity to the point where we are operating as a micro model nation in the world. And I'm putting the responsibility as an older man, as a former politician, on the shoulders of those two fellows here, and those who are either in their parties or in other parties, whether for them or against them. And if I'm for you, it doesn't mean I am going to accept anything you say. I'm going to challenge you. Robert Bratcher taught me that as a little boy. I remember one day he was speaking to me, I was about 6 or 7, and I was in awe of him. He was a regular visitor to my home. He was married to my aunt. I used to do a lot of little things for him. We were very close to each other. And one day he was talking to me, and I was just listening for about 10 minutes, almost transfixed. And Mr. Bratcher said, "Boy, what's wrong with you?" I said, "How you mean, Uncle Robert, what's wrong with me?" He said, "You're not going to challenge me? Anything I tell you, you're going to swallow? Boy, challenge me." Because by challenging him, I might give him a perspective he didn't have before, as small as I was. And that is what leadership should embrace, difference. It is natural. You don't have the same kind of fish, the same kind of bird, but we're all God's creatures inhabiting a single planet. And we have to learn to work together in the politics and beyond, Mr. Conway.
Thank you, Mr. Astafan. What you just said, as a small boy, I grew up here, and my father's making the statement that I should always doubt. For doubt is the shaitan put to intelligence. So I see transfer it now into the political realm. Challenging is good. But I want to make a statement here then, a question to get your
opinion. If I may just say very quickly with respect, a challenge must not be taken personally. The challenge must be respectful, but it must be robust. It must not end up by saying something about your mother and your sister and your this and your that and so forth. If there are things that are disreputable and attachable to you, and they are a part, essentially, of the public discussion, then so be it. But we tend to go for the dirt before we go for the substance. And that's not good.
The statement that I want to make here is that you would find that there have been accusations by a number of individuals and political parties, especially when they were in opposition. You would have found that they would say things like, for example, if you would find an individual or individuals, they're claiming that those in government are being accused of victimizing the public servants, members of the public service. And in so doing, if it's a fact, why is it you're doing it? But I listened to what Mr. Stastafan said just now, that you would find that individuals staying on for lengthy periods, unlike what Mr. Nital said, you would find that they would remove important documents and so forth, and not given access to the incoming administration so that they can work on that. So there's a difference. But I have this question here. I would like to have your brief opinion. Why new governments do not give credit to their predecessors for the positive things they inherited, such as a healthy treasury and viable projects? I would like to hear briefly from each of you.
Well, you're looking at me, so I'll jump in.
You're to blame.
But it's a good question, and it's a fact. I think new governments fail to do that in many instances. And at times we do overlook when they actually do give credit. I wish my government had the opportunity to compliment its predecessor on leaving us with a good treasury and good debt, but that's not the case. But let me touch on something that I am personally involved in, and that's the St. Kitts Music Festival. And we have continuously spoken, especially as we are now getting into that mode, about the tremendous strides that particular event really catered towards tourism has made over the years. It is something that we believe is certainly worth continuing. Do I, if I'm correct, that began under you, right, under your watch as Minister of Tourism, some 21 years ago. And it's something that we believe needs to be continued. We acknowledge what, you know, the impact, not just on gate receipts, but on the wider community, the economic impact on St. Kitts and Nevis. And we continue to acknowledge the foresight of the former government for introducing that. And our intent to build on top of that. Again, you look at Port Zante, where it was initially considered or called by one side to be structurally poor in engineering and this and that, and but at the end of the day, it became probably one of the two foremost points of interest as it relates to our tourism product. And we look at where the cruise tourism has grown in recent years, and where the new tourism minister, the Honorable Lindsay Grant, has been able to build tremendously on top of the work that his predecessor, Ricky Scarrett, did. And so I think that is an even better example of how what not to do and what to do, in terms of how you look at practical things that benefit the country in general, and you forget about the petty party politics.
Okay. Before we get the next member of the panel to comment on that, in my research, I had found that during Pam's tenure, I think from 1980 to 1995, what was brought up here, the construction of Port Zante, and the Kennedy Simmons Highway.
Yeah, to him.
You want to know it?
Mm-hmm. It was the highway to nowhere.
It's on the highways everywhere.
But now what we find happening is that the economy has moved away from sugar based, and it is now
more touristic.
Straight to tourism, and this is the boom.
Tourism financial.
Yeah, and then when we look at the highway to nowhere, this is where we find that massive construction is being done there. And even locals are also utilizing that area to ply the trade. Even look at the sea bridge, the one that bridges the St. Kitts and Nevis. No, that was inherited by the St. Kitts Nevis Labour Party, even though some statements were made about what they're doing. It is now in the hands or in the bosom of Team Unity. So I am saying that it started there, whereby you inherited it, you haven't given credit. The Labour Party didn't give credit. Team Unity isn't giving credit also. So I've just heard from you, and now let's hear from Dr. Drew.
Right, I appreciate it. I'll go even further back in history, and you spoke about the transition of government during 1980, and I mentioned a few of the major things that were achieved on the St. Kitts Nevis Labour Party under the leadership of Robert Llewellyn Bradshaw. And, in terms of having suffrage, in terms of taking us to statehood and really setting the pace for independence, in terms of our comprehensive health plan or educational plan, and really the modern structures, not just physical, but in terms of governmental and otherwise, that set the stage for the country that we have today. So this really determined where we are today. But let me say one or two things with respect to the modern time. Gaston Browne in Antigua, for example, had the opportunity to open the new airport in Antigua. And he invited to that ceremony the predecessor, I think Baldwin Spencer. And that, of course, shows a great level of political maturity. John Powell, my friend here at my left, just mentioned about, he wished that he inherited a good debt and treasury and stuff. But I think that, it is in good standing. I think over $700 million was left in the treasury, $700 million. And the debt to GDP ratio had come down to about 60% when it was 200% And so I think that, you know, if you're going to get credit for the debt situation, I think that, you know, credit should be given also to the former administration. But I take the point that we need to give credit where credit is due. Even with the music festival, happy to hear that credit is given to the St. Kitts Nevis Labour Party as far as this is concerned. And I really would not take any credit away from previous administration, for example, the Port Zante. I will not take credit away from that. But to wrap it up with respect to the tourism situation, tourism minister, I think that Ricky Skerry is not given enough credit. I think he would have put in train the construction of the new pier that we were about to see here. He had already set up really a cruise timetable that is now benefiting our country tremendously. And to add, our country was on track really, or is on track, if it continues, to really be debt-free by about 2020. But let me say, at least we are ahead, should still be ahead of the other OECD countries when it comes to when it comes to the debt ratio, of course. And so what I would say is that, you know, as I said, the new administration have been inherited. And I could even speak about, you know, the CBI program, which took a lot of flak but continues to present, that all these things that we are seeing, a lot of it was put in place, you know, by the former administration. And of course, credit should be given, and credit should be given even further back to those who really deserve the credit. So what I'm asking for, and what I look for as a new politician, one who's aspiring, is that in the future there would be changes that my generation will be able to introduce as far as this.
Thank you.
Okay, I think what is happening with parliamentarians, they're behaving like the prosecutors and the defense in a courtroom. Prosecution especially, they're not advocates for justice. They're advocates for conviction. So even when you have exculpatory information that you can bring in a case matter, they tend to exclude it because they need a feather in the cap and they want to go for the conviction. When you have the parliamentarians debating, because you call it a debate, it creates the atmosphere of antagonism. You have to oppose regardless of what is being said. And if we could only get the time when you can reduce the debate to a discussion, because they are tending to need bipartisan discussions. I read about Dr. Joe and Mr. Hamilton apparently planning to come together to assist in the crime situation in the Kiron region and must laud him. And that is a good idea. It's good. There are times that we need to get away from the debate and have bipartisan discussion. And until we reach that level of maturity where our ego do not present barriers to the progress of the entire federation, we are going to be lagging behind. We're going to remain stagnated with respect to solving certain key and critical issues for the country to move forward.
Thank you, Mr. Africa.
Well, I don't want to get entangled in a political argument, but when you seek to take credit, you must also accept responsibility. On the point of the debt reduction pointed out by Terence, the debt to GDP ratio should never have reached 200%. The land for debt should never have happened. And the land for debt deal with the bank, in which the government is still paying $18 million a year in interest, is still an unsolved issue. The land has not been sold, so the bank does not have its money, and the matter is still very much tied up in limbo. So I don't want to get entangled in an argument on this, but every government has performed to some extent, and it is my very simplistic and optimistic opinion, maybe even quixotic, that each successive government should be better than the one before. Just like we want our children to be better than we are, and so forth. And we must take responsibility. As I said, maybe on another occasion, Dr. Joe and I can debate this, and we happily and maturely and responsibly. But it is important. The genesis of the tourism industry, for example, Mr. Conway. Frigate Bay was started by the Bratcher government. The airports and seaports were started by the Bratcher government. The manufacturing sector was started by the Bratcher government, and a host of other things. I was the spokesman for the Labour Party in tourism when Port Zambie had begun, and I was one who had said, I have some concerns with regard to the engineering, with regard to the configuration of the piers and so forth. And Mother Nature came on two occasions and confirmed that my concerns were correct. These were corrected. Every government has performed. But governments get elected and they get thrown out. We have to look at the good and accept it, and we have to be sober and honest about the mistakes or the misdeeds and make sure we don't repeat them. It must be an ongoing process of improvement. But we can't be selective with the facts. Otherwise, our credibility will suffer. And I want these young men here to go forward in a more wholesome manner than their predecessors have. Otherwise, we're going to be in a lot of trouble in this country.
Okay, thank you for that, Mr. Asifan. Now, gentlemen, it was good having you here, but I would like you to, I'd like to give to you 30 seconds each to give your final thoughts. Let's wrap. I'm starting again from the senior man.
Okay, well, I want to thank you and thank your organization. I think this is a good start. I think this, you're establishing a new platform for productive engagement and a good distillation of ideas. And whatever I can do in my own little way, I'd be happy to continue, God's willing, to assist how I can.
Thank you, Mr. Asifan.
I've always liked life to the playing of an orchestra, where the boisterous tuning up comes first, followed by the sweetly blended harmonious music. And this is a learning curve, and then it can only get better. And I want to wish you, the institution, and our stakeholders well in continuation of such a lovely program.
I think that you have an excellent program, and of course, after you told me about it, I said that you know this is a new discourse, and I will definitely get involved, because I think that the more media that one is exposed to, of course, you can disseminate your ideas, and ideas are what bring about change. I would like to say a couple of things with respect to the calling for the crime solution in Kayon. That is part of what I think we should do going forward, that there are issues where we can work together to benefit the community, and not everything should be brought down to petty politics. And so I look forward to doing more of that type of things. But I would also say where criticism, and as Jonel said, constructive criticism must be laid, then I agree that it must be laid there. I want to thank Doyle. Of course, he mentioned one or two things about the debt and said, maybe in the future we can have a debate on those things.
Certainly.
I look forward that somebody would have been in politics all this time with a wealth of knowledge that we can share and exchange as far as that is concerned, because I look forward really to raise the debate and to expose our people to all sides of the information, and of course we can find a new way when we do that. And let me wrap up by saying that I like the topic today. I hope I'm not engaging in a blame game. Let me say I'm not engaging in a blame game. I'm engaging, having a robust debate, and where credit should be given, it should be given, and where people should be called out, they should be called out, and where we find common ground to work together, we must work together. And so I want to thank you and congratulate you on this forum, and congratulate your staff and this inaugural panel. You got out in my history that I was here. I appreciate it very much. Thank you guys for the debate.
Finally, Ambassador Powell.
Well, congratulations to you and SKNVibes again on this forward step. I believe today, and the program will continue to encourage progressive discussion, positive discussion. I certainly feel that way about what happened here today. Certainly for me, I went into politics because I wanted to do better. I wanted to see a change in the thinking, the philosophy, the maturity, not just of politicians, but of us as a nation. and Dr. Drew has referenced our generation, and I hope that our generation can do, as Doya said, much better than those before us, so that we lay a foundation for the following generation to come. And so, you know, let us use discussions like this. We can sit where we can sit down and debate, and we might not agree with everything that has been said, but the debate was had, and we left here, I think, a bit more wiser, a bit more understanding. And if we can channel that to the wider public, I believe we'll all be on the right path going forward.
Okay, gentlemen, I must thank you for being here at this SKNVibes inaugural discussions on political, social, and cultural issues in St. Kitts and Nevis. And I hope sincerely that this will not be the last in seeing your faces. And I know that Mr. Astafan will be here again, and I hope that the three of you will be seen by the general public,
yes,
and given your thoughts, because I have seen an amalgamation of thoughts on all saying one thing, educating the public and bringing them under one umbrella. You're talking about nation building. And what is it you say in the political realm? With who is first? Country first and not self. So once again, thank you, gentlemen. The bottom line of today's topic on the blame game is a very interesting one. We have heard the comments and opinions of the four panelists, all of whom have agreed that political parties should desist from blaming each other and focus more on informing the public about progress in development. Thank you for watching. Until next time. However, for all comments and feedback, you can reach us at newsroom@sknvibes.com.